is the day that the Lord hath made. And I will rejoice and be glad in it. So give him that praise and let him know thank you and I'm glad for what you have done. Our God and our Father, again, we thank you. You've given us that brand new day. You've given us brand new grace and mercy in this day. For God, we come before you right now, and first and foremost, we say thank you. God, we ask that thou would just be in the midst of our worship, that you would be in the midst of our heart, our mind, and our soul. That God, that we that have gathered together in this place might glorify you, lift you up, let you know how much we love you. For those that are watching, that they're doing the same thing, magnifying your holy name. For those that are on their way, God, we ask that when they get here, that they would be in the spirit to give you praise and to give you glory. Now, right now, God, just have your way with us. Have your way with our service. You said in your word where a few would gather together in your name, you would be there as well. So, God, we've gathered in your name. That's the purpose of why we make an end here. We're not looking for anything else but to give you glory and to give you honor. Thank you for what you've done and what you're going to do, because you're God all by yourself. Now have your way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. In the nicest name of Jesus the Christ, we pray, and all that love the Lord say amen,
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 and amen. Amen. In your bulletin will be our morning song. We'll understand it better by and by.
Take us unaware.
Again, we are looking for all of our members to come out on the 29th of September, which is a Saturday morning, 10 o'clock for our church meeting. At that time, there are a couple of things that we need to discuss and put into play. So again, we're looking for everyone to mark it on your calendar. Come out on the 28th at 10 a.m. If there's some things that you need or you want to discuss, please, prior to getting to our deacons or our trustees, that they may bring it up in our joint board meeting as well. And again, October 2nd Sunday, we will be celebrating the women of the church. Reverend Rose Dean will be our speaker for the morning. And so again, we want to encourage our women. We want to encourage you to invite people to come and be part of our service on that day. Now, the last Sunday in October, we will as well be talking about all of our officers and our auxiliaries. We want to celebrate them as well. So again, we want to encourage people, to invite people to come out and be part of our worship service. On the 26th will be a meeting for those that want to volunteer and start working on year 96 of our church anniversary. So again, these are things that are in your bulletin. Put them on that spot, that refrigerator, on your cork board at your desk, whatever it may be, so that we can make sure that we're there and fall into compliance of what's going on. Always be mindful and remember those who are sick and shut in. Remember those families that are bereaved. While you're on your knees, while you're in that secret place that you go to talk with the Lord, just ask Him to bless those that are going through something, that they may be lifted up, that they may be encouraged in their time of sadness and sorrow, or in the time of healing. Well, how many of you know that God is a healer? God can do all things exceedingly and abundantly well. So again, remember Sister Eula Andrews, Brother Otis Appley, Sister Martha Freeman, Brother Robert Freeman, Brother George King, Brother Stevie Rice, and Sister Marie Rice, and then those that fall under a prayer request, Sister Mary Freeman, Sister Kim Johnson, Sister Sheila Miles, and Sister Margaret Stratton. Again, we never know when we're going to be in that situation. And so if everybody's praying the same prayer, the Lord will hear our prayer and answer it. Amen?
Amen.
Come on and stand to your feet. Go to the book of Job. May sound like Job, but it's Job. Go to that first chapter and go to the first verse. Now, I'm just going to read a few verses. Read the whole chapter. And then after you read that chapter, hopefully you got a little hunger. Those of us that have read it before, read it again.
Amen.
Don't say, well, I know. There's some things in there you don't know. And God will reveal it and open it up to you so that you can see it. Amen?
Amen.
Let's start at verse 7. And the Lord said unto Satan, whence cometh thou? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, doth Job fear God for naught? Hast thou made a hedge about him, and about his house, and about all that hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the works of his hands, and his substance increased in the land. Put forth thine hand now, and touch all that thou hast, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath in his power, only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. Go to verse 14. And there came a messenger unto Job, and said, the oxen were plowing, and the asses feeding beside them. Go down to verse 21. And said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. Amen.
Amen.
It's prayer time, church. So let me just say this first. The altar's open. Maybe everything is okay at your house. So I'm challenging, if it's okay at your house right now, then I'm challenging you to come out with somebody else. I'm challenging you to come that God might have truth unto the people. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of foolishness. I'm tired of senseless killing. I'm tired of the abuse, misuse, all of those things that are going on. I'm tired of news. The only thing they report is about who got killed, who got beat up. All of those things are not who God is.
That's right. That's right.
So we need to know that the Bible says that the prayers of the righteous availeth much. So we need to know that there are some fools out there getting ready to do some stuff. That there's some people out there, some young people, that are already plotting to do some stuff in our schools. That there's some kids plotting to be bullying other kids in school. That there's some adults plotting to bully some people on their job and in their neighborhood. But here's where the church can step in and stand up and pray to God. The Bible says, if my people who are called by my name would turn from their wickedness and hear from me, then I will. That's why we come today. We're praying for those mothers out there yet still carrying that unborn child. We're praying for the infants that have come into the world. We got to stop being selfish and start thinking about future generations. So when we pray today, we want to pray in unity. We want to pray the prayer that Christ, through Christ, that God will hear our prayer. I can't tell you about any other place, any other church, but I want our church to be a praying church. I want our church to be that church that he comes back for. So all I'm going to tell you today is open up your heart, open up your mind. If you've got some burdens, pour them out on the altar right now. You've got some problems, some situations, let them go on the altar right now. You pray for somebody else, pray that God would touch and move in such a holy way that person would be lifted up out of their ashes, lifted up out of their muck and mire, and come yielding unto him, saying, what must I do to be saved? Oh God and our Father, focus on. Because we know what you can do. We know what you've already done. And God, we know your capability is endless. So first, thank you. What you've done to us, we need to say thank you. For God, we realize that too many people are going into your place about the pastor. They're going in about the name. They're going in about the size. They're going in about the choir. But God, we showed up because of you. We come because there's nothing else that we need to learn except your word, your will, and your way. So God, right now, in the name, the only name that is capable of doing all of these things, right now, in the name of Jesus, we just say thank you. God, we realize that we're living in a cruel and mean world. But God, we know that you've got more power than the wicked world has in the hand of your God. So God, right now, we're praying right now that you would just have your way. Somebody entered at the altar right now, God, wants you to move in their life. Somebody right now, God, is standing at the altar for somebody else that is standing in the gap for. So right now, God, we're here because we know you can and we know you will. So everything about us is asking you to teach us your way. Lead us in your way. Right now, God, somebody right now is going through something that's on our sick list and going through something in the nursing homes and going through something in a hospital. Somebody's on the street corner going through something. But oh God, right now, have your way in their life. Right now, God, speak unto them. God, let them come yielding unto you and say, what must I do to be saved? Somebody right now, God, doesn't know how they're going to make it. Somebody right now, God, has entered in and doctors have given them a bad notification. But God, we know you just stepped right in. That what the doctors can't do, what medicine can't cure, we know you got it all in the hand of our Jesus Christ and Lord and Savior, God. Right now, God. Right now, God. Somebody's contemplating suicide. Somebody is in a deep depression. But God, stop by. Change their mind. Change their vision. Change their hope. Right now, God. Somebody needs to be fed. So stop by, God. Give them some fish, two loaves, God. Right now, God. Do it. That they might have more than the two fish and the five loaves. That they might have some more left over after you die. Somebody right now, God, needs a shelter in the time of storm. God, you promised that you would always be there and you would never leave us nor forsake us. So God, right now, give them a shelter. Right now, God, as the storms of life are raging, stand up and speak peace in their life. Right now, God. While men, women, boys, and girls are looking to our government, right now, God, let them look unto you. For you control all governments. You control all people. God, right now, we just need you to send somebody our way. That we might be a witness unto them that you are a savior. You are a healer. You are a provider. You are a friend. You are a mother. You are a father. You are a dear wiper. God, right now, somebody needs to know that it's you that will make a way for them. So God, we thank you right now for this little branch of life. We thank you that the doors swing on the hinges of Jesus Christ. We thank you right now, God. We thank you, God, that through seasons of unseen and seen, you've been faithful to this branch of life. And the truth be told, you've been been faithful to us when we haven't been faithful to you. You blessed us when we didn't deserve it. You gave us grace and mercy when we didn't deserve it. So we say thank you, God. God, we just want you to have your way. God, we want you to use us. We want to be used that we might lift you up. That we might tell somebody what you've done for us. So right now, God, for every petition that's laid down at the altar, in this place and every place opened up in your name. But God, not just this place and every place opened up in your name, but God, at the cemetery, at the funeral home, right now, God, at the hospital and the nursing home, and right now, God, on the street corner and in the jail cell, for every petition made known to you, in your name right now, God, move on it. At your will and in your way. Make it known that you're still God all by yourself. That you answer every blessing that's put forth in the name of your Son. Now God, we praise you. We magnify you. We lift you up. We shout hallelujah. We glorify you. We praise you. If we just kept on saying it, we couldn't thank you enough for what you've done. So have your way, God. Have your way. Until these tongues can't speak no more. Till these voices have been shut up. Till these heads cannot clap anymore. Till these feet cannot stomp and dance for you anymore. Until we see you for ourselves. Until we can hear you say, well,
Lord.
12th verse. But all of it is important because you need to read certain words. If you don't know what they mean, you should look them up.
Yeah, yeah.
12th verse says this. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of God. I want to talk from this thought. God's plan will not destroy you. God's plan will not destroy you. Last week we talked about learning, the learning curve, and that is to say that teach me thy way, O Lord. Lead me in a plain path because of my enemies. And if we have surrendered ourselves for God to teach us his way, then whatever comes our way, we ought to know that God is in control of it. God has a sustaining plan for each of us. You have no idea of what God has planned for you. Sometimes that plan doesn't look the way you want it to look. Have I got a witness? You thought you were going to do this? I need a witness today. And God decided to do that. You thought you were going to go this way? And God sent you a whole nother way. But I want you to know that we must learn to be faithful in whatever direction God is sending us. We need to be faithful to God teaching us his ways. You see, for some of us today, we need to know because God had a different way for you, you're still alive right now. Because God had a different way for you, you were healed from your sickness. You were bought out of your distress. You were bought out of your muck and your mire because of God's plan. It may look as if God is trying to destroy you, but the truth of it is that he is trying to remove all of those things that are going to cause you a problem, and all of those things that we take in and idolize in our life. Let me tell you, and I don't want to make anybody my enemy, but when you say, I don't know what I'm going to do without you, sometimes it's that very person that has caused you the heartache and I'm going to help you this morning. Sometimes that job, that thing that you wanted so bad is the same thing that has caused you more trouble than what I didn't tell you. There was a fad some years ago, it's still around. It just changed what it is that they wanted. Some years ago, there was the fad of 8-ball jackets. Everybody was walking around with the 8-ball jackets. And people that couldn't afford the 8-ball jacket stuck them up, beat them up, and took their. Now it's if you. What's the hottest pair of shoes, Miles? Basketball shoes. Nike something? The Nike Michael Jordan something? Michael Jordan, whoever, whatever they are. If they see you with them,
well,
in school, out of school, come on, you'll help me. You worked hard, and you got that nice car, and they come along and jack you for. Because you thought the car was what made you. You thought the eight ball or the jacket or whatever it is that you were trying to get to make you something was making you. But God stripped all of that from you to try to tell you that you belong to me, and I got a plan that's greater than any plan that you can come up with. Amen. God's not only got power, but he's got authority. Satan may have some power, but he has no authority. Can I just say that one more time? That you've got to understand, he's going to try to do some stuff to you. And the stuff he's going to try to do is about the things you got and the people around you. But how many know no weapon formed against me shall ever prosper? Because God's got power and authority. If we are true believers in the word of God, then whatever his way is, whatever his thoughts are, we should let him have the way of what he wants us to do and the direction he wants us to go. There's that point that it's hard to kick against the prick. Every time you kick against it, you think you're doing something, you just hurting your own self. You see, God has a way that's just not like our way. And sometimes if we just stop and go the direction that God wants us to go, we'll find out that God has rewards for us in every plan that he puts forth for us if we just follow his will. Don't be caught off guard of things happening to you. If you've been alive just a few days, you see what the world is doing. If you've been alive for a little while, you see death is going to come. But we can't get caught off guard because the word says and Christ says that I took the sting out of death and I took the victory from the grave. Yes, yes. So if we are in God's plan and God is directing us and moving us, then we don't worry about the grave. We don't worry about death because God's got it in his plan that we should have life and have it more. God's way has a test built into it. That's part of what we miss. That every time God does something, he's testing to see whether you're going to lean on him or whether you're going to lean on the world. You see, every time that God puts the test before us, we've got to keep our direction, and we've got to understand that he will keep us in perfect peace. When doctors give up, that's when God works best right there. When money's gone, that's when God works best. When refrigerators are empty, that's when God works best. When others turn their back on you, that's when God works best. When you get in the secret of your tabernacle, that's when God works.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. I've spoken to you before about God's permissive will. And his permissive will take you through some challenges of your faith. God, sometimes just let some things happen because you thought you knew better than God.
Come on now.
Y'all might be quiet this morning. Within God's sovereign will, he chooses to permit many things to happen that he takes no pleasure in. You remember that son that thought he knew everything, lady? Say, Dad, give me mine. I can make it work better than you can make it work. Give me mine, Dad, and I'm going. the indirect accomplishment of God's will is often called his permissive will. To say that God allows or permits evil does not permit God to allow it to happen. Sometimes we go against the will of God, and that's why sin enters our life. I saw this and I thought it was so apropos. I saw a preacher and he was talking, Brother James, and he was saying that when he was a young pastor, he was single, and he was talking about the fact that he was just going wild. He said, I had women coming through the back door, women going out the back door, coming through the front door, going out the back door. He said, and one of the mothers of the church said, Brother Pastor, come on by my house, I just need to talk to you. And he went by the house and he said, Mother, how can I help you? She said, Pastor, I know you're young. And I know what you're doing is some of the same things some of us in the church do. She said, but it's now it's time for you to turn your porch light on. Y'all hear me? You got to turn your porch light off to sin. You got to stop allowing sin to come into your life. Y'all ain't helping this morning. You got to stop sin from coming in. When you see sin, get away from sin. When you see sin coming by, walk the other way. We got to stop allowing sin. God is not sanctioning the sin in our life. You're getting away with something, but you're not getting away with it like you think. God is going to punish us at some time for what we don't do to follow his plan. I need to tell you, here's where we need to understand that God is not concerned with materialistic things. And he's not concerned with flesh and blood, but with the soul of each of us. You can get your best clothes on. Get some of those red bottom shoes. Get some of that main stuff. Get you a nice Rolex. If you're in the hats, get you a Stetson. You know, all of that, and get you good looking, Levon. But if you ain't done nothing with your soul, everybody should say, God is concerned about our soul. We're concerned about materialistic things, and God's concerned about our soul. We're concerned about gaining everything over here, but God's concerned about you gaining it in his kingdom. I'm almost done, y'all. Look like you're getting mad. So Job is the perfect example of God's plan not to destroy us. Job and the plan stands clear today for you and for me. We want God to stop everything, and yet we fail to stop all the things in our power and in control. One of the things that Job was titled with was being an upright man by God, who feared God and shunned evil. That word shun means shun. Understand the difference between shun and put down. Matthew 7 says, judge not lest ye be judged. Don't put people down. Pick them up. They haven't come through these doors or some doors opened up in his name. Don't put them down. Build them up that they might come unto him and get their burdens released. A man, as described by Job, a man of his character is not perfect, but certainly complete in his devotion. Listen to me.
you say thank you, God. Thank you. I forgot yesterday to thank you. You brought me through something. You put food on my table. You were right there with me. Thank you. I found out in the middle of the night, if you begin to praise him, thank him, he will put you back to sleep in perfect peace. You hear me?
Job had sheep, goats, Job had many children, and Job had Job's children and houses and all of that. Somebody will just talk about his wealth and talk about generational wealth, but that's not it, church. That's not it. We're trying to gain so much here, and we're losing everything up there. Job, his family was blessed. Can I tell y'all that because of Job's faith, his family was blessed. And Job would send and sanctify his children.
Yes.
Now read in here, because I want you to read this. His children were acting like the prodigal son. My daddy got this. You know who my daddy is?
Yes.
My daddy got money. My daddy got this. My daddy. How many of y'all know people or kids brag about their daddy, but they ain't got nothing at all? Listen to me. The word says Job would get up early in the morning, and he would pray for his family. He'd get up and he'd offer burnt offerings for his family and for all that God had given. The book of Job is about an epic war, and yet there was no city attacked and no city besieged or no city conquered. No battles are won and no battles are lost. No oceans are sailed, nor nations founded, nor adventures recorded. But there was a battle going on.
Right, right.
So this is what I'm going to tell you today, church. The battle is going on right now in you.
Yes,
and
yes.
What Satan's trying to do to you.
Yes, yes.
You see, somebody ain't going to like it, but I'm just going to say it. If this is our day of worship, everything else ought to be out the door.
Amen.
We ought not be concerned about our children playing this, our children playing that. We ought not be concerned. You need to go to your person who you work for and tell them, I'm not coming on Sunday. That's my day of worship. That's my day of praise. You can gain some dollars, but you're going to lose your life. The whole conflict happens on an ash heap, virtually a garbage dump outside of the village. It's an epic war, but one of the inner life is where the battle is. A struggle to make sense of some of the deepest questions in life.
Yes.
Who will I serve? How will I serve? Are you going to serve our God, our Savior, in spirit and in truth? Or are you going to serve him in lip service? Sometimes we forget that the battle of our lives happens at a whole nother level than what our eyes can ever see. Satan is trying to use you to break the will of God. We are made in his image. He don't care about nothing you got. He wants your soul.
Amen.
Can I say it one more time? He wants your soul. And you know what the scariest part is? He doesn't care who you are. He doesn't care the color of your skin. He doesn't care where you live. And the problem is that he's going after our children. He's going after the young ones, and it ought to cause us to be upset that he's attacking our children. That's why the Bible says, train up a child in the way that they should go, and when they become old, they will die. So let me give you these things real quick. I told you Satan has no power, and his power will throw things at you. Bible says that we must put on the whole armor of God. That when the fiery darts of the world begin to be thrown at us,
people close to you. Whatever the devil touches, whatever he destroys, and whatever he steals, let him have it, because God will give you better than you had before. There's nothing that Satan will not do to try and to steal your soul. There's nothing that he won't do to try and to destroy you. I hear Satan say that if you take your hand off of Job, I will make Job curse you. God said you can take anything he has, but you can't touch his soul. I stop by to tell you, God's got a plan for you. He's got a plan for your soul. Be more concerned with your soul. Be more concerned that God got his hands around your soul. I stop by to tell you today that if we stay in chapter 1, things don't look good, baby. But I want to tell you that at the end of chapter 1, the Bible says that Job had prepared himself. He said, naked I came in, shall be. Job said, I'm not going to charge God for what Satan tried to do. Too many people are charging God for what has happened in their life. But I stop by to tell you, do I have some faithful people that hold on to God? Unchanging hands. We sang the song. We'll understand it. Then by and by,
and guess what? It was good for Jesus. And because it was good for Jesus,
Jesus, you ought to know it is excellent.
Baptize somebody. Yes. And I'm grateful that God sent a young man like you.
Hallelujah.
That you Good citizens as well as good believers.
Amen.
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 Like Pastor Andrew said, I don't know. You got your point across. Amen. Thank you again. Don't forget our offering.
Amen.
I don't hide it up because that's what we should do.
Amen.
Give as God has blessed you.
Amen.
I ain't trying to beat something out of you that ain't in you. God's going to bless you. You give it, God gives it back to you better than you gave to him.
That's right. Amen.
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 And let us be mindful that we like to come in and lights are on. We like in the hot time, some air, winter time, we like some heat.
Yes.
The organ ain't working right, we won't get that right. Drums break, on and on and on and on.
Right.
And on. Amen?
Amen.
And it makes it easier for our trustees.
Yes.
Look at somebody if you're bold enough. Grab the hand if you got it. You ready?
Amen.
Ready?
Ready.
Tell them, God,
plan for you.
Will not destroy you.
Will not destroy you.
But make you what he wants you to be. Look at somebody else. Look at somebody else and really get it together now. Say to them, God,
plan for you.
It's not to destroy you. But to make you better
for what
he has for you. One more time, look at somebody and say, God's plan
for you
is not to destroy you,
but
to make you better
for
what he has for you. Go in peace, my brother. Please do not forgive me again. In the back are some vegetables. Come and get them in the back. If you don't need them, take them to somebody that does need them. Amen?